And welcome to Future Perfect Tech Shorts. Tonight we look at a new wireless data communication standard called TV White Space or TVWS. Led by the Information and Communications Technology Office of the Department of Science and Technology, pilot tests of broadband connectivity using TVWS are being scheduled in select remote and unserved public schools in the province of Bohol. And with us in the studio is DOST Undersecretary and Executive Director of ICTO, Luis Casambre, and the Chief Technology Officer of ABS-CBN and SkyCable, Raul, Bulaong. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for coming to the show.
Good evening, Donnie. Thank you.
Thank you. And TV white space is a consequence of the TV industries worldwide, I guess, shifting to digital. Di po ba?
Not exactly, though. It's called TV white space because there is a lot of unused spectrum frequencies in the TV band. No, if you notice as you turn your TV, well, the old TV, rotary dial, you'll find there are blank
snow.
Channels. Somebody came up with the bright idea. Why don't we use this?
Okay. No?
It's going to waste.
Yeah.
No? So that is where the idea of TV white space springs from.
Right.
To use the unutilized frequencies. No.
But what I actually meant was as a consequence of the shift to digital, because in the United States, diba, they already rolled out the digital broadcasting, parang mandatory na rin for all of the broadcast stations. Na maiiwang vacant na yung mga dating inoccupy nila na analog TV channels. But as you said, no, the white spaces, they already exist. But would they necessarily be used only when our own broadcast industry shifts to digital, or it's still possible to use the TV white space even if analog pa rin tayo?
Yeah, we can use them. There's no need to
move. So no interference?
Well, that's why we have to do these pilots. Okay. We have to figure out what the correct settings should be.
Yeah.
No? But there seems to be no, we cannot say that there it is not possible. No? Especially since, unlike in the United States, or for example, here in the Metro Manila, right now we have over 50% white space.
Okay.
And it's even greater.
Marami
pa po. In the provinces, it goes up to 100%.
Mm-hmm.
No? The low is up 80%.
Okay. So these are unutilized TV frequencies talaga.
Yes.
That are actually out there. Kung hindi, kung meron lang gusto sana magtayo ng broadcast station, bibilin mo lang
yon
frequency na yon, or you have a franchise for it.
So
Raul, when it comes to using kunwari TV white space, tayo channel 2. Sabi nila the lowest frequency ang dumi-dumi ng signal, di ba? That's why we need to spend a lot to improve our signal propagation. Will we be affected kung gamitin bigla yung white space? Magkadikit na tayo ng 2 tsaka channel 4. Eh.
Well, in the US, they did not use the white spaces
the
in
lower
the low
frequency.
Bands.
Yeah. Low band.
They only started using it above 5.
Okay.
Above channel 5 is when they started using it. So
so
I don't think it's tough kasi since it's a free it's unused and it's in a very low frequency. The problem with that is the interference that you can get. So you'll get spotty signals as well. So it might not be a good idea. Although we haven't really tested.
So kung tayo, kunwari, ABS-CBN, our own lookout would be wag gamitin yung TV white space between 2 and 4 as a broadband frequency.
Yeah. Tony, let me say that it is a basic principle that white space devices, white space technologies, should not interfere with we call them the incumbent services. Those are the TV stations,
the existing stations,
yeah, as well as the wireless mics and whatever other technologies are authorized in the TV band.
Right,
that is of paramount importance.
Okay, yeah. So kung kunwari, ibig sabihin nun yung between 2 and 4, meron pa rin pwedeng magtayo ng broadcast station using that or wala naman?
Under the current, no.
Hindi na?
No.
Because masyado nang magkadikit yung...
Well...
Dati ka, di ba, nung uso pa yung Betamax, eh, Channel 3 yung ano?
Oh, yes.
Nakapaghalataan na lang uso ang galing na panahon. Betamax, di ba?
Yeah.
Pag sinaksak
mo
sa TV, lagay mo sa Channel 3.
Mm.
So, yeah. Yun lang ang gamit nun. Parang, it's not gonna be for broadband, obviously. Hindi pwede.
Malamang.
Malamang hindi pwede.
We have to investigate.
Still investigate. Yeah. Okay. So the idea is all broadband frequencies are radio waves pa rin, just the same, right? Which is what TV signals are. They're also radio waves.
Right.
How efficient are the TV or the radio frequencies of the TV white spaces in propagating kunwari, broadband signals?
Okay. That's what makes TV white space technologies they have a term for it, eh. Parang, these are the sweetheart frequencies.
Really? Yeah. Talagang pang Valentine's Day na episode.
Oh. You know, because these frequencies, these particular frequencies, travel so far.
Okay.
They travel over water, through
But
through
it depends
your,
on the power
walls.
Of the transmitter then, no?
Yes, but inherently, for the same amount of power,
they travel longer distances.
The higher frequencies will not do as well as the TV band frequencies.
So, ano bang band ang pinag-uusapan natin dito? Siyempre, okay, Channel 2 yung inumpisa natin. What are the white spaces that we can utilize? Anong numbers to sa TV mo, kunwari?
Raul, everything in between the analog channels.
And analog ends in what? Kasi kuminsan nakakalito. Saan bang end ng analog spectrum?
There's VHF, which goes from Channel 2 to Channel 13. And then the UHF, or the ultra-high frequency, which starts from 14 to 50...
So Studio 23 69. Kasama na doon?
69, yeah.
Studio 23 kasama na sa
Studio
ultra-high
Studio 23
frequency.
Is UHF, yeah.
Okay.
So, in analog, because it's analog, they can't put two channels
at the same frequency.
Na magkatabi.
Yes.
It has to be separated by one, what they call guard band,
okay,
to protect them from interfering with each other. That guard band is white space.
It's the white space.
That's the white space.
So, yun ang silbi talaga, no? Di ba? Parang kung isolate.
Actually, the white space is not only the ones in the
middle. Correct, yeah.
We have a lot of spectrum or unused channels na sulud-sulud sila, dami-dami. There's not only one channel in between.
Oh.
But you might have 10 or 20 or
kasi
50
merong,
channels.
Kung kunwari, ang frequency mo ay 10, merong 10.2, 10.4, may ganon.
No, Tony. What I mean is
in chunks of 6 megahertz.
Like somebody's operating channel 23.
Okay.
The next one is all the way up in channel 43. So you have 30 channels in between. There.
Okay. No? And as Raul said, di ba, parang you actually increase the ano ba yun, tawag ba yun, amplitude ba of the frequency in terms of megahertz, no?
Yeah, well, it's in chunks of 6 megahertz.
6 megahertz.
That's the standard in the Philippines.
Okay.
Yeah.
So marami po tayo, Director Casambre, magagamit na white space.
Yeah.
No? I mean, theoretically, how many of these white spaces can be utilized for broadband propagation?
Well, again, we have to study it. Because, you see, we have to calibrate the propagation characteristics to the specific terrain. No, so kung nga po yan, actually white space technologies rely on a geolocation database.
Okay.
No. Against which the devices ask permission, can I operate here? What channels can I use?
Okay. No? Okay.
And then based on where the channels are, no, and where the other users are, the database will tell the device, okay, you can use this channel.
Yeah.
At this power level, or it can basically nagtanong siya ng permission.
Yes. Yeah. So you'll have to find out. Sa ngayon po ba, Director Casambre, ano ang ginagamit na frequencies ng broadband ano natin? Wireless broadband natin ng mga telco.
Ano mga telco? Well, they have several bands.
900,
1.2, I believe.
Okay. No? Iba pa yung sa LTE bands, no? Yun yung mga bagong niro-roll out ng mga telco.
Well, actually, LTE is LTE technology. They can use it in the particular bands they have.
Okay. So, lahat ba nito, like say, we're talking about 3G technology and now the newer LTE or 4G technology, which is really making waves kasi ang bilis-bilis nga ng internet speeds, eh. Will these be supplanted by the TV white space?
No.
What will be the impact on the current technologies that we're using?
Well, if we take the longer point of the long-term point of view, the TV white space provides an entry point for those who cannot yet afford these better services from the telcos. No? That's the way we're looking at it.
So the 3G and LTE are considered better services?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
No.
Actually, not only the wireless, but also the DSL, the wireline technologies. No? Yun talaga, they cost more because the cost of the infrastructure is more. TV white space infrastructure is, we think, will be a lot less, magnitudes less.
Mm. And does that mean that you can make broadband wireless internet even more affordable for ordinary consumers?
Well, it was surprising. No?
Theoretically.
I was telling Raul, no? The FCC has a plan to make free
Wi-Fi.
Free for the whole country, for the whole United
Wi-Fi.
States.
Mm.
Wow.
And that's controversial for them, right? Because,
because nobody
is thinking of giving away free Wi-Fi. Yeah, not unless you're some rich coffee shop, right? But before we continue with with TV white space and how it's going to be used for broadband, are there other uses for TV white space that are being considered now by...
absolutely, Tony. No. For example, you may have heard of our Project NOAA.
Yes, of course.
This depends on... weather stations sending data to our servers,
right,
on which we base the projections that we showed in Project NOAA.
Yeah.
Imagine if we could put sensors in places so remote, and so many of them, it would enhance the power or the information that Project NOAA could deliver to the public.
Mm.
White space can provide that solution.
I see.
Right now, we have, for some of them, we have satellite links.
Yeah.
But these are too expensive. If you want to put 10,000 sensors all over the country, it would probably be prohibitive.
Yeah.
But with white space, very, very possible na siya.
Okay.
No?
So TV white space isn't just going to mean that you can help give people wider access to broadband, wireless broadband, but also to help in the
disaster mitigation, e-government,
data collection, basically.
There's so many applications.
Mm-hmm. So is TV white space going to have, is it going to have to be regulated the same way as yung frequencies for broadcast stations? Kailangan i-bid out din and like begin a franchise? Paano po ba yan?
Well, that's the current discussion.
Yeah.
This is actually brand new a brand new frontier.
Yeah.
It's in between our laws for broadcast and the laws for telcos. It's somewhere in between there. No? So that's why we had that workshop recently, bringing all the stakeholders together to start the discussion.
I see. Yeah? I see. What does that mean for the future of broadcast, Raul? Because obviously, we're already experimenting with digital broadcast. Right? Yeah. Hindi pa lang natin ma-roll out because I think the standard has to be agreed on,
yes.
No? But for us, when we're looking at ito applications of TV white space, does that mean that, say, broadcast companies can also use these TV white spaces, other TV white spaces, not for TV broadcasting, but for other purposes that we can offer?
Yes, of course. There are other uses for broadcasters or content providers like us, like ABS-CBN, no?
Yeah.
Where it can provide, say, interactivity. Mm. On TV, parang internet TV.
Okay.
If you're able to harness those extra frequencies that are still free, that can still be used.
Mm.
So, I guess one thing that's good to note for TV white spaces, one of the main reasons for this is really to try and get internet access to far-flung areas.
Yeah.
Because of the nature of this band, this frequency, it can go far.
Mm-hmm.
So the idea is you throw it to a rural area, and then in the rural area, you put the Wi-Fi router, and they share the Wi-Fi router in that community.
Mm-hmm.
So the idea is, I think one of the things during the workshop that came out was really inclusive growth. That was the discussion where the rural areas can actually start contributing, or or benefiting from the new information that they will be getting.
Sure. Meron pa po ako isang naisip, and you know, this is just out there. I don't even know if it's even practicable, di ba? When they had mock elections for the PICOS machines, one of the problems that attended it was supposed to be the difficulty of transmitting the data to the servers, because parang, I don't know whether walang signal or what, right? If we actually utilized white space, would that make the transmission of data, say, for example, from a PICOS machine, more efficient or, say, less troublesome?
Well, given that these frequencies have superior propagation characteristics, they can reach further.
But is the data going to be secure once it's transmitted through TV white space?
Just
like any other technology, you can secure the data.
You can, but with algorithms, no? Encryption.
Yeah.
So may encryption din siya pwedeng ilagay.
Yeah. Yeah.
So hindi yung parang i-hack mo yung signal, so pagdating ng boto ni Mayor, less 1,000 na siya, parang gano'n, hindi naman.
Yeah, so I don't think, just going back to your question, I don't think it's easy to say that it's more efficient for the PICOS machine.
But
because it's a matter of how big, how large or how big the coverage of the network that you built is.
Yeah.
So if the PICOS machines are using 3G technology, it really depends on how many cell sites they have out there.
Right.
So the same goes for white space. Mm. It depends how big the network design is, if it's really going to reach that.
And who's going to design that network? Because the TV white space is practically parang unowned, di ba? Parang it's free, but it will basically, as you said, pwedeng i-bid out, like the existing frequencies.
Well, Tony Connett, we look at this as a collaborative effort between government
and industry, the private sector,
both telcos, broadcasts, as well as all the stakeholders. We have yet to find the exact answer, but we intend to find it.
Okay, what's the target date? I mean, you're going to be piloting it in Bohol, right? Tama ba?
Yeah. The pilot in Bohol will start in June.
So school year, no? Pagpasok ng school year.
Yes, nandun, no? The procurement process already underway, no? But we're looking to partner with the private industry, no? To really do other pilots, no?
Okay.
Because
so for the ABS-CBN.
I would think so, no? Of course, again, it has to be within the current frameworks that we have.
Of course, ABS is law abiding.
Indeed.
Indeed. Dalawa kami dito.
Okay. Yeah, I'm sure.
So
I'm
June,
sure.
Pilot testing, putting up the infrastructure, no? And then anong ibig sabihin nito? Parang are you experimenting, say, with computer terminals hooked up to tong TV white space frequencies receiving data from the internet, no?
Yeah. One of the applications. Of course there are actually multiple applications. One is for education, one is for telehealth, one is for CECs, general e-government service.
Yeah.
Kind of. But there's also one for the fishermen. No?
Fishermen.
Ito ko naman to, for environment management.
Okay.
No? We're doing this in partnership with the USAID.
So may mga modules, no?
Yeah.
It actually covers different segments of society. Okay. Well, we've run out of time, but June is just around the corner, basically. Pero bago doon, election muna, syempre, the most exciting time of the year. But we want to see what happens to the pilot test in Bohol. So we'll probably invite you back and tell us how the project is going on once it starts on the ground.
Yeah.
In the meantime, Director Luis Casambre and Raul Bulaong from our very own ABS-CBN Technology Office, thank you very much for coming to Future Perfect, gentlemen.
Thank you.
And hope to discuss TV white space with you some more. Hindi lang si Casper, the TV white space. Right. Thanks very much.
Thanks for having us.
Coming up next, we look at the latest Firefox mobile OS and the latest camera from Olympus. Stay with us. You're watching Future Perfect Tech Shorts. Welcome back to Future Perfect Tech Shorts. Mozilla recently launched their App Day series in the Philippines, where developers can create apps for their new Firefox operating system.
Developers from all over the world came together over the weekend to produce the latest apps for the Firefox mobile operating system. App Days showcased the unique features of the OS, which is entirely open source.
The Firefox marketplace is open source, and so that means that we're showing people how they can use the technologies they already know that make websites. HTML, CSS, and JavaScript can be used to make apps as well, and so you don't need to learn something entirely different to make an app for Firefox OS.
Manila was one of the 24 worldwide locations that hosted the event. Local developers were given the chance to explore the open-source capable operating system. Many developers had the opportunity to showcase their own mobile applications.
Those three applications were created both by faculty students of Gordon College. And those three applications were Ruben's Adventure, done by students, also MyTools Plus, done by students, and QWERTY Typing Test, done by the faculty. We have already created a lot of applications. We just ported some of them to Firefox from a web app. We ported them to the new operating system.
The event is very exciting for me because there are a lot of developers. There are a lot of skillful developers who are present during the event. And it was a good chance for me to collaborate and to talk with other developers and help each other developing for the Firefox OS.
Mozilla also announced the release of Unagi, a smartphone made for the developers to use as a testing ground for their applications.
The prototype device we have today is called Unagi, and that's just the code name. So it's a developer phone. It's not going to be the final version of the hardware that you're going to see when the Firefox OS phone comes out later this year. The Unagi device is just for Mozilla developers right now. It will not be released as a consumer product. Something better will come out.
It looks like 2013 will be an exciting year for developers and smartphone consumers. From games to productivity applications, Firefox OS is providing a gateway for more mobile possibilities.
That it is. While a new type of malware that disguises itself as an app allows hackers to take over your mobile device and computer, and a very capable compact digital camera wins raves from a professional travel photographer, here's a wrap of some of the more interesting happenings in the tech world this week.
There was a time when big, bulky cameras were absolutely necessary to get great photographs. But with the advent of compact micro four-thirds, or mirrorless cameras, this is no longer the case. Recently, these smaller, handier shooters have been giving DSLRs nearly twice their size a run for their money. And the latest offering from Olympus looks set to maintain this trend. Last year, a digital photography review called the OMD the most accomplished micro four-thirds camera so far. And it quickly gained a following among serious photographers. Singaporean travel photographer Kim Lau is a convert. During a recent trip to the Philippines, Kim was all praises for the OMD.
Size is not important for every kind of photography, but for on the go, for the normal people, for travel, it's so important. Imagine I personally do, or rather I aspire to do all three. It means still photography, video, and sound. I have a reservation in carrying the bigger bodies and the bigger lenses as well. It's not that I've not done it before, it's just that now I'm trying to do more, so I need things to be small.
Besides taking great photos, the OMD also takes great video.
The stabilization is very, very good. It's almost like a Steadicam. I mean, that's for real.
Thanks to its five-axis stabilization system, the OMD virtually eliminates camera shake in videos. But as great as the OMD is, we can't help but wonder when Olympus and other camera manufacturers are going to put social media capabilities into their products. Especially now that people prefer to view and share their photos on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. Last year, computer security experts sounded the alarm over the discovery of a malware that was infecting computers and even mobile devices across the world. Dubbed as FinSpy, the software can grab images of computer screens, record Skype chats, turn on cameras and microphones, as well as log keystrokes. No OS was safe, as even Android, BlackBerry, Windows Phone, Symbian, and iOS devices were infected. The malware was discovered to have been a surveillance tool made by a British firm. It was so sophisticated that it was virtually undetectable by most antivirus software. SpinFi's British developers, the Gamma Group, said it was selling a legal product that enabled governments to monitor criminals and terrorists. But internet activists said that the software was actually allowing governments around the world to spy on their citizens. This year, another malware has cropped up that appears to be as insidious as FinSpy. Oddly enough, the malware called Droid Cleaner is a downloadable app on Google Play. According to Kaspersky Labs, Droid Cleaner allows hackers to send text messages using an infected phone, enable Wi-Fi on the phone, gather information about the device, open arbitrary links in a browser, and upload the SD card's entire contents to a hacker's server. And when an infected phone gets connected to a PC, the PC also gets infected. The last time we checked, Droid Cleaner was no longer on Google Play. There is no word, though, on how many devices have been infected.
Scary. Time to bring this phone to the doctor. Now, thank you for joining us. I'm Tony Velasquez. You can join me again next week when we again examine the present and look ahead to the future perfect of Philippine tech.